rich niggas. You know, so we ain't really never had no old money. We got a whole lot of new money, though.
Yeah, young Metro, though. Trust me, I'm gonna shoot you.
Hey! Raindrops, drop top, smoking, no cooking, the hot pot.
Cooking,
fucking on your bitch, yeah, dot, dot, dot. Cooking up, dope in the crock pot, pot. We came from nothing to something, nigga.
Hey.
I don't try nobody, grip the trigger,
nobody.
Call up the gang and they come and get gang. Cry me a river, give you a tissue.
Hey.
Bad and bruising,
bad.
Cooking up, dope with a oozing.
Bah.
My niggas are savage, ruthless.
Savage.
We got thudders and 100 rounds, too.
Gah.
My bitch is bad and bruising,
bad.
Cooking up, dope with a oozing.
Dude.
My niggas are savage, ruthless.
Hey.
We got thudders and 100 rounds, too.
Gah. All set.
Records on records, got backers on backers. I'm riding around in a cool,
cool.
I take your beat right from you, you. Bitch, I'm a dog. Beat down her walls, loose.
Hey.
Hop in the frog. I tell that bitch to come for me.
Come for me.
I swear these niggas is under me.
Hey.
The hate and the devil keep jumping me.
Jumping me.
Back rolls on me, keep me company.
Cash.
Hey, we do the most,
most.
Yeah, pull up and goes.
Woo.
Yeah, my diamonds a choker. Holding up, fire with no holster.
Bah.
Read the ruler, diamond cooler, cooler.
Good afternoon, everybody. We are back to Big Man of Campus, and we are live. Tuesday, February 21st, 2017. My name is Jeff. They call me the Big Man on Campus. Here with you live on a Tuesday, breaking down college basketball. You know what it is. We're back. Couple days off, but we're back. 5 o'clock. You know what that means. Welcome to everyone out there listening. As always, we're here to chat about everything going on in the world of sports. Yep, we'll get to it. We'll get to it for sure. Yep, we're going to break down everything here as always. Welcome to everyone out there. Trim, Trey, Jason, Nick, Guan, Jay, Frank, Ben, everyone. Donnie Wrightside's joining me live. He's going to be my co-host and co-pilot today. Donnie, how you doing today?
Doing good, BMOC. What's going on, my man?
Good. Always good to hear from you, brother. As always, Donnie, my partner here now. If for anyone that doesn't know, we'd love for you to join us tomorrow. Starting tomorrow, Donnie and I will be doing a new show at SBR Sports Picks, SBRForum.com. It's going to be every Wednesday and Friday. It's going to be called The Right Side of Campus. We're breaking down everything. Really just mostly about college basketball, but just a glimpse into our lives as handicappers and everything and kind of what we do on a daily basis and chat with all you guys as well. So we urge you, get on Google. We'll be promoting the hell out of the show as far as where to find it. I'm really looking forward to it, Donnie. It should be fun.
Yeah, man. I mean, just something, you know, that guys like to talk about sports. You know, we're not all people that live on the Vegas Strip in, you know, big suites up top at, you know, $5,000 to $10,000 a game. It's the everyman's betting show. It's going to be a lot of fun. And as Jeff said, we're going to bring a lot of people into our environment of what we look for, what we do on a day-to-day basis. And again, you're going to put, you know, we're putting ourselves in your shoes there, you know, betting each and every game, what you want to break down, you know, what you want to talk about, you know, previous night's action, bad beats, terrible referees. I mean, it's going to be a show that's about everything, and it's going to be a lot of fun to do, man. I'm looking forward to it, big man.
Yeah, it's great because on the Google Hangouts, which many will get accustomed to, it's similar to the show we have here where it's, you know, it's an interactive show. You can interact with the listeners. And it's just overall really a fun thing. So I look forward to that. If you have any questions, feel free to DM me and we can get you the link on where to find it. But it's going to go live 12:30 sharp Eastern time. So definitely look out for that. Donnie and I not only friends in the betting community, but we're actually friends outside of here. We're actually heading to the Temple game tomorrow night, Donnie, you and I.
Amen. So that's right. We'll be down on North Broad.
Yeah, we know each other outside of here. So should be fun. Look out for that. But it's all about tonight, Donnie. Today is February 21st. I feel like we haven't been on the air in a little bit, but we're back. We'll break down most of the games tonight. As always, I'll throw out a couple free picks. We'll get Donnie's opinion on some of the card as well. Take some questions, and you know, we'll chat a little bit about some NBA stuff. We have you know, the trade deadline bearing down on us here, and all sorts of stuff. So let's jump into the action here. As always, again, these are free picks. These are games that, for whatever reason, didn't make my card. They were close, but just for whatever reason, they didn't make the card. So let's jump into it here. First game on the docket. Interesting one here. This has a lot of implications to the bubble right now. Virginia Tech laying 1.5 against Clemson, over under 152.5. You got a Virginia Tech team who I think squarely at this point in the field after their wins against Virginia lately and other teams. And you look at this Clemson team, Donnie. They're on the outside looking in at this point. This is not a tournament team. And again, we look at the fact that in 7 years at Clemson, Brad Brunell has taken this team to one tournament. And it looks grim as far as this one as well. You look at coming in here, this team is 2-7 as an underdog this year. Virginia Tech has made it abundantly clear they are very difficult to beat at home. This is a 13-1 team in Blacksburg, 84 points a game, 50% shooting. That's downright impressive. Still in the middle of February, you're still shooting over 50%. And on the highway, Clemson has been very average, 5-8 straight up, only shooting 42.5%. And defensively, they've had major issues. That's been one reason they're not able to win games like Miami on Saturday. Their defense has been bad. They just haven't been good enough on the defensive end. You look at lately, giving up 52.5% shooting. Look, this one for me, though, the one issue I have here and why I didn't make this a premium play is the line. The line looks a little shaky. The one thing I will point out, though, this line, I don't know that it's that crazy. I mean, Clemson really needs a win. Clemson is really, if they lose this game, they're pretty much dead and buried at this point. And you know, Virginia Tech, for what it's worth, I mean, a good team, I'm not sure they're a very, very good or great team. They're definitely beatable, but that's why it's not a premium play for me. It's close, but it's not close enough. I definitely also wonder, Virginia Tech does struggle at times to rebound the basketball. Without Chris Clark, I'm not as enticed to back them now. So for me, it's a free play. I definitely think the job can get done here. I'll be having it in as a small wager. Any opinion here, Donnie, on this one?
Yeah, I mean, just taking a look at Clemson on the whole, and we talked earlier on the round table. I mean, coming down the stretch, you want to be playing your best basketball if you're going to be a team that's on the bubble. It's so funny, Jeff, that you're looking at Clemson on the bubble. What teams do you know on the bubble have dropped 10 out of 13 games? Not really that impressive even of a start. You can always bank on Clemson in the past doing what? Playing good defense. Look at their past 13 games. 11 of those games have gone over the Vegas total in that one. This is a team where I can't be buying down the stretch. And even though Virginia does have the key injury, they're a pretty good team at home. I completely agree with you when you look at the spread saying, why is it only 1.5? And Clemson, Mia and you both, Jeff, we bought Clemson a little bit on Saturday saying, give me the points versus Miami. Miami had a key suspension, and Clemson really needs this game. They came up lame again, so it's not one of those things where I know you're talking about most of the people, Clemson really needs this game. They can need it all they want. I just don't think they're very good.
Yeah, I agree with you 100%. I just think at the end of the day, I think, like we said on the show earlier, I think that just goes to show how bad this bubble is. I mean, the fact that Clemson's lost, 10 of 13 or whatever, yeah. I mean, that's just not good enough. And for me, again, Teddy Covers always mentions, the great Teddy Covers, just because they need to win doesn't mean they're going to win. Listen, does Clemson need to win? Yeah, but I mean, we saw on Saturday they needed to win and couldn't. So against a Miami team that, look, I mean, without Jaquan Newton, they're definitely beatable. So yeah, for me, I'm just not interested in Clemson. I think Brad Brunell after this year has got to be fired. I just don't really understand how this guy continues to be a coach in Clemson. I just don't think in 7 years you made the tournament one time. That's just not good enough. So for me, I'm going to go with Vatek here. I like what they've done at home. Only lost one time this year in Blacksburg. That place is really a cool place to play. We saw obviously, Virginia had some problems there. I'm going to go with Vatek here as a small play here in this one against the Clemson Tigers. Next game, and I think if when I say this game, many are going to understand why this is a free pick. Again, it is the slightest of free plays. I got to admit, I don't like this card tonight. Donnie, I know you and I both kind of talked about that.
Yeah.
The card, not only last night and tonight, have not been good. Last night, I didn't have a play. This tonight, I only have one premium. For me, tonight, I'm going to take a shot with the Kentucky Wildcats on the full game, -16. Look, again, many will probably look at this and say, well, you know, you're going to be nuts laying this number with Kentucky right now. You would be right. I mean, this team's not playing well. I mean, we all know that. Defensively, they've had issues. You know, they've had cohesion problems at times. But, and again, they have Florida on deck. But, listen, I really don't think that they can take Missouri lightly in this spot. And at the end of the day, even backups, I think Kentucky's light years better than Missouri. This Missouri team is dreadful. I mean, they really are dreadful. And, you know, I just look at this game as really a get-right game for the Kentucky Wildcats. They really haven't had a knockdown performance in a while other than, I know recently, I'm trying to remember who they beat. Recently they had a big...
It was Vanderbilt.
Oh, right. Yeah, and, you know, a game like that where they just kind of led wire to wire. No, it was... I'm trying to remember. Oh, it was
Vanderbilt and it
was Tennessee, actually, recently. Tennessee, they just kind of led wire to wire. It was just kind of a blah victory. And I know they're playing with revenge there. But listen, this Missouri team is awful. I mean, they are really dreadful. 7-19. They're just not very good. They only scored about 69 points a game. And that's been the main problem, scoring the basketball. They're shooting under 40% on the year. And I got a feeling Kentucky just blitzes them here, you know, kind of just batters them and wins by 20. They need to kind of get right and feel good going into a basketball game. I just can't really feel like they're going to come into this game and have any reason to take Missouri lightly. And at the end of the day, like I said, even playing at 80%, I think they're much better than the Missouri Tigers. Last year, you look at the meeting last year, 88-54. Not sure it'll be that ridiculous this year, but you know, I think this one's in an 81-62 type of game. I just think Kentucky does what they have to do, win by about 20. Listen, if Kentucky struggles in this one, I don't know what to tell you, but I hope they can get it straight on the road here in a bad Missouri team.
No, I mean, if looking at that point of view, Jeff, I do agree. The only thing I worry about is just Kentucky getting complacent tonight, being 1-5 against the spread. Excuse me, against the spread. Last six games on the road. The one thing that you have to like in this equation is the physicality of Kentucky going against Missouri. Missouri just doesn't match up. They're not big enough. They're not strong enough. The one thing that you hope is Coach Cal really is beating into their head. It's coming into SEC tournament time, heading into March Madness. They have to get it right. You can't come out and, you know, play games and take it easy in the first half and then turn it on. And when you have teams put away, you have to really drop that hammer. The one thing Kentucky's going to be able to do tonight, Jeff, and I agree, they're going to be able to score at will. Who's going to be able to defend down low against Adebayo tonight with 2 points? If you look just at 2-point percentage field goals, 53% Kentucky. If you look over at Missouri defending that, it's 51%, dead last in the conference. They should be able to just pound them down low repeatedly. It's how much Kentucky wants this game to run it up. And I do take it as an aberration where I said earlier, the Missouri game versus Vanderbilt. I have no idea how they beat Vanderbilt by 20, but every once in a while those games can chop it up. I would look myself to stay away because I just don't trust Kentucky that much yet on the road, but there's no way I would be backing Missouri in any environment at this point in the season.
Yeah, I mean, I do look at, like, for instance, in their non-conference, I mean, they played, Kentucky had a lot of blowouts, and they were against teams better than what Missouri's done. Now, obviously, they're two different teams probably at this point, but Donnie, I think it's safe to say that if Arizona State and Missouri played together, who would win that game?
I wouldn't just end the coin flip. The coin wouldn't even turn on its side, I don't think.
Okay, well, you would agree, though, Valpo's better than Missouri.
Yes.
I mean, you look at some of these matchups. I mean, Kentucky is battering some of these opponents they should beat. I mean, again, I don't know what to tell you against Tennessee. That was just a two-point game that they lost. It is what it is. They came back and slammed them. Listen, other than, and I think we can agree at any point, other than Tennessee, has Kentucky been that bad? I mean, they lost to Kansas. Nothing wrong with that. They lost at Florida.
They were in a bad spot in that Florida spot, so I almost give them a pass.
Right. I mean, listen, are they rolling in games? No. But they're winning. They're getting the job done. We have to remember, in the big picture, they don't care about covering. They're winning games. They've had some slip-ups. They're young. I just think in this spot, you really can't afford to go light. And they've gone light, and it's not worked well for them. I think they just come out, and they're just much more talented than what Missouri is. Let's move on here to the next one, the third and final free play that I'll give out. I'm going to go with Ole Miss. I'm going to take them here against Mississippi State. They're plus 1.5 in this spot. Got to wonder why they're an underdog here. I don't really get that. this is one of those, another one where I see a team that's very good as an underdog, very good on the road, and I just think a better team. Mississippi State's been a tough out for teams, you know, getting 12, 13 points. As a favorite, I don't really understand why they're a favorite in this spot. Obviously, this is a rivalry game. We can point to the fact that Ole Miss, you know, beat them soundly earlier this year, 88-61. Does that constitute them being a favorite here in this spot? I don't think so. Mississippi State's lost 4 or 5. They're not playing particularly good basketball right now. And you look at Ole Miss over the last 3 years, Donnie, 23-9 on the road against the spread under Andy Kennedy. Kennedy, for what it's worth, he's had some bad luck, but he's had some good teams at Ole Miss. He had Marshall Henderson. He had Stephen Moody. He's got DeAndre Burnett and Stephen Saiz. I like this team. I don't think Quadri Witherspoon is enough for Mississippi State. That's really all they have at this point. Listen, they're going to sneak up on you as a big underdog. But in this favorite role, I'm just not really sure they're really the team that should be laying any kind of points here. I like Ole Miss. I think if they can just get some stops tonight, I think they're going to win this one going away. And I think we have to look at, in a close game, Ole Miss, 76% from the free throw line. Mississippi State, 68%. Could be a big thing in this one. I think the one reason I'm concerned here, Ole Miss does struggle defensively. I mean, they're giving up 77 points a game in conference, and they haven't been good against the three either. It's concerning, but I like Ole Miss in the underdog role and the way they played the Bulldogs over the last couple years. I'll go with Ole Miss here as the third of final free play. Any opinion on that one?
Yeah, I mean, it's a good point you bring up there. I mean, Mississippi State is 4-1 against the spread in their last 5 games, but you're asking them to win the game tonight. What does that mean over the last 7, Jeff? Only 1-6 straight up against the number. I know it's a home game. It's in-state. I get the whole rivalry aspect. But if you even want to look back a couple years with Kennedy being the coach, he owns Mississippi State. I mean, Mississippi State 1-6 against the spread last 7 games when playing Mississippi, and 1-6 straight up in those 7 games as well. So if you're going to look to the nod of one team that has a psychological advantage over the other, Jeff, I agree. It's got to be the Rebels.
Yeah, and I mean, at this point, I mean, look, I like Ben Hallen's doing down there, but, you know, he's a good coach. But, you know, I think in this year, you know, Ole Miss is just a better team. I think they're going to go out and get the job done here. And take care of business. Let's move on here to the rest of the card. I know people are interested in certain games here. And there is some early games here that, again, if you don't have an opinion, feel free. We can just slide over it here. 6 o'clock Eastern, Rhode Island at LaSalle. We talked about Rhode Island on the roundtable today. Listen, I'm not interested in laying points with Rhode Island or betting on them on the road. They're just not very good on the road. And look, we talked about it. Is this team good enough to make the tournament? They've had injuries all year. It's always something with this team. Look, LaSalle sucks defensively, but they can score. Will they hang here? I don't know. It's a tough game for me. I have no interest in backing Rhode Island, not only as a favorite, but on the road either. And look, we could talk about Rhode Island and that they're better, but this team has struggled to shoot the ball all year. I mean, they're shooting 43% on the road, last 5 under 40%. Look, LaSalle can't defend, though. I have no opinion. Do you have any opinion here?
Not much on this game. The only thing I will give a little bit of a slight nod to is LaSalle. They finally have their big three back with Price, Johnson, and Powell. And they did have a nice showing against St. Joseph's. But that's St. Joseph's now coming back down to earth after the 2 best guards are out for the season. Rhode Island's going to be a major step up. But if you look back even a week ago, Jeff, same sort of spot. I know Pookie Powell wasn't playing, but Richmond came in the Tom Gold Arena and beat them up pretty good by double digits on that same talent level. Is, you know, Rhode Island coming into town, even a better team technically than Richmond. They're going to be in a tough spot here, but I'm not interested in laying, you know, any number with Rhode Island going on the road unless they prove it to me. But tricky type of scenario, you know, you might have gotten that preview last week against Richmond with them.
Yeah, it's definitely a tough situation here. I mean, they need this win. They can't really afford a late season loss here to LaSalle. But
no, they need to close out. We talked about that earlier, Jeff. They definitely need to close out with a couple. With the wins heading right into the tournament.
Yeah, I mean, at the end of the day, I mean, this is still the team that went on the road and couldn't even crack 45 against Fordham. So, you know, it's concerning to me, Rhode Island. Listen, they have a lot of talent. It's just they haven't put it all together. And for what it's worth, I've been to Gola Arena. It's a very intimate atmosphere there. And again, you look at this year, LaSalle, 10-3 straight up at home in line games over the last 3 years, 27-15. So, you know, LaSalle can surprise. Am I looking to bet them here? I'm not looking to bet either of these teams. Purdue, Penn State, this line's kind of moved down. People are betting Penn State in this spot. You know, I'm not really sure I see it, though. Purdue, we know, very good in the ATS role, very good as a favorite, pretty good on the road over the last number of years. Listen, Penn State's a nice story. I'm just not looking to bet them here. They've struggled to get stops lately. That's never a good idea against Purdue. I think Purdue's starting to heat up a little bit. They've won 5 in a row. They're covered in those games. They've covered 9 of 13 in the Big Ten. At this number, I would back Purdue.
I mean, yeah, looking at the game itself, a couple weeks back, I think we even had the same sort of scenario as we were talking previous, when Maryland came in there in an early game. You know, Penn State sort of snuck up on them. But Maryland is a completely different team than Purdue is. If the going is not good with your guards, you can always lean on the big men down low. You know, if your jump shot's off, I mean, they can play defense. They have enough of what it takes. Purdue in their last 5 games, as you said, Jeff, certainly heating up, 5-0 straight up, 4-0-1 against the spread. Penn State is one of those, you know, hardworking type of teams, but this is, to me, the cream of the crop in the Big Ten. They're going to get really pushed tonight. I see the number coming down. I know it's sort of a sharp type of angle to take Penn State getting those points, but when push comes to shove tonight, Jeff, does Penn State have enough to hold off on Purdue? And they're going to be able to throw that ball down low and do whatever they want tonight.
Yeah, I'm not really, listen, Purdue is a team that I think long-term, I'm not really big on them, but I think against a team like Penn State, like you said, should be able to throw it down low and kind of do whatever they want to do. So, again, I'm not high on the game, but if I had to bet it, I would go with Purdue here. Oklahoma, guys, listen, again, this is probably the 10th time I've said this. You don't need to ask us about a certain game. We'll get to it, I promise. We're going to definitely get to them. Oklahoma, Baylor. Baylor ain't 12.5, over under 136. I mean, is anyone interested in laying double digits with Baylor? I mean, raise your hand if you are. I don't see anyone raising their hand. I'm not interested. Again, though, I mean, this should be a game Baylor should roll in. Jordan Woodard's out. Oklahoma's just lost. They don't play defense whatsoever. They can't shoot. I mean, Baylor should roll here, but Baylor should still be a number one seed, and they pissed it away. So is anyone really interested in Oklahoma in this spot? Or Baylor either?
I wouldn't be.
Yeah, I don't know how you can be. Listen, Baylor should get right here, but, you know, Oklahoma is, you know, they're desperate, I guess. I don't know if they're just playing out the string. Just a weird game all in all. I don't have too much of an opinion on it. Auburn, LSU, two bad teams, particularly LSU. Auburn slowly kind of went down the tubes. They failed to cover, you know, lately. They're pretty much an average ATS team. I think the way to go here would probably be just swallow and lay the 172 and take the over. But if you're betting on this, I think you have a major gambling problem, to be honest. What do you think, Donnie? Anything?
I mean, 1-13 LSU in the SEC. That's unbelievable. I mean, you're not talking about a murderer's row going up and down that card. I mean, and they are getting blown out and beat up nightly. I thought I even saw a quote the other night from Bruce Pearl saying how well LSU has gelled this year, and it's amazing the way they're playing ball. I don't even know who's more out of touch in this one. So betting, you know, a road team that doesn't cover, doesn't play a heck of a lot better home than away with Auburn. And looking at LSU, I'm tired again of all the, you know, sharp money coming in on LSU. LSU's going to make a play tonight. LSU's going to stand up to this and that. LSU's just a bad club, and the worst thing you can do with the team is when you're going nowhere is back them. Is there going to be a home environment tonight for LSU? Are they going to be, you know, standing room only and get really excited? It's a dead type of atmosphere, so whether or not it's home or on the road for LSU, it doesn't even matter.
Yeah, it wouldn't matter anyway, because at the end of the day, I just, listen, for one with Auburn, I think you're always going to get a nice effort from them. I mean, I think they're young. I still think long-term, year or two from now, I think they'll be a decent competitor, but and they can shoot as well. LSU's lost. I don't know why you'd back them at any point. Back to Rhode Island quickly. A couple people are talking about the over in this game. Just remember, I mean, this Rhode Island team can be dreadful at times offensively. I mean, really bad. You know, and look, LaSalle, for what it's worth, I mean, this team has not been as good offensively lately. They've had some struggles. They seem to struggle against good defensive teams. You know, they struggled the other night against St. Bonaventure to score. And, you know, that is a fairly high total for Rhode Island games. Rhode Island's still very good on the defensive end. And, you know, I could see a situation where they're really held in check tonight, LaSalle. But, you know, again, good luck if you look into the over. Just wanted to point that out. South Carolina, Florida, I don't think we had to spend a lot of time here. This line looks a little too small, to be honest. But, you know, it's eight for a reason. You know, will it be the game that, you know, they just kind of roll in and they're winning by 10 the whole game? Or will it be last night with UVA where they really didn't sniff a cover at all? I don't know. I think Igbunu going out for Florida hurts them a lot. But, you know, this could be ugly. South Carolina is an ugly offensive team. And they've had issues. I don't know if you've noticed, Donnie, but you're looking on the road. And
I don't like them.
Yeah, lately they've had South Carolina major issues. I don't think South Carolina is very good, to be brutally honest with you. I would actually lay the number here. I think Florida, the only thing I'm concerned with Florida is they do have that look-ahead game to Kentucky, and that's concerning to me. I would probably play Florida here just because I don't think South Carolina is very good, but you know, do with it what you want.
Yeah, I mean, Canyon Berry a little bit banged up with the ankle, and of course the bigger injury to Florida's big man who's going to be out for the season, that's going to hurt. But if you watch South Carolina, Jeff, I mean, I know there's some games where, you know, if you look 83-76, 90-86, even though that was a four overtime game, I can't stand Frank Martin's offense. I mean, it literally is, they bring Felder the ball up the court, dribbles it, stands at, you know, the about 6-7 feet outside of the three-point line, doesn't do anything, waits for a call, 10 seconds left on the clock, and they just basically say, Thornwell, please do something with the ball. It's one of the worst offenses that you're going to see run. They play a slug, knockout, defensive type of game where they play great man-to-man defense. They're as good as it gets in the country. If you look on the flip side tonight with Florida, same type of tenacious, aggressive defense. I think this game probably has a better chance of staying under the number on the actual over-under than if you're going to take, you know, 6, 7, or 8 points, because if you watch the way South Carolina moves the ball, I mean, it's not pretty. They're not going to come down. They're not going to break you down one-on-one. They're not going to look to hit, like, you know, wide-open jumpers. It's an ugly, ugly type of offense. Well, I would look more towards the under here than actually the line in the game itself.
Yeah, the problem with under here is the under has been definitely bad. I mean, it's unopened 142.5, you know, down to 138 at this point. But still, 138 pretty high. I mean, you're definitely – you're basically backing on, you know – that they get to, you know, 70 apiece here. I don't know that I see that. These teams can get ugly. South Carolina, you mentioned major issues at times scoring the basketball. And, you know, Florida, I mean, I don't know. I definitely think they're revived, though, as far as offensively. They're a lot better this year on the offensive end. But, yeah, I mean, not a game I'm rushing to the window to bet on.
Yeah, I mean, if you look at that previous one, Jeff, when they matched up, 57-53 final in that one.
Yeah, that's brutal. I mean, that's just ugly. I actually remember that game. It was super boring. It was an early start as well.
They look to push it. The point guard is unaggressive, which, again, I love when it's an under. If your point guard is not going to bring the ball up the court, look to beat his man up the dribble, that's at least a, you know, what, 20-second offense there that they're going to be shooting with under 10 on the clock. I look for more of that tonight than I would as, like, an open run-out game, but that's just the way I'm leaning on that one.
Yeah, I hear you. Let's kind of rapid fire these MAC games. Northern Illinois, Central Michigan. You know, Central Michigan guards should be able to kind of do what they want to do. I think down low, Northern Illinois, decent bigs should be able to have what they want to do down low. Listen, I mean, Central Michigan 17-6 to the over this year. very high total, clearly, but I don't know. I don't really have a read on Central Michigan. They're just so bad on defense, it's hard to get in love with them ever. Anything there?
And not really. I mean, it's all about making shots with Keenan Race in there. How they go is how Central Michigan goes. I mean, you've seen it in the past, Jeff. We've watched games, you know, going back and forth online together. Central Michigan's up 10, 3 minutes later, they're down 5 points because they don't have any clock shot management. It's if they're going great, they're going to put up 100 points. If they're going so-so, they're going to get beaten a lot of these games. The one thing you like about Northern Illinois is the toughness that they bring in, very athletic. A similar type team would be like a Buffalo, which they would match up very well with, but I'm just not interested in Central Michigan because I don't know if I get a clean enough read on them because it's too guard-centric. It's not like, you know, when we talk about Purdue where if you're not hitting your jump shots, you throw it down low and see what you can do and rebound well. If those two guards aren't going well, Central Michigan is a terrible team.
No, they are, and that's what the Miami Ohio took out of that book. They shut down Keene, made them kind of double guard Keene, and it was over. Western Michigan, Toledo, I don't think anyone has an opinion on that. Kent State, Buffalo. You know, again, we see some of these numbers in the MAC seem a little high. Kent State, though, off a big win against Akron, you would imagine this would be maybe a little bit of a letdown game. Listen, this Buffalo team is pretty real, particularly at home, particularly lately. And on the defensive end, they have been good at home, giving up under 66 points a game. I think this one looks high, but Buffalo should be able to take care of business here, especially off a big win that Akron had on Friday night.
Yeah, you know me, Jeff. I've been telling you, I've been buying Buffalo for a couple weeks now, hopefully heading into the MAC tournament. That's going to be one of my not-so-sleepers anymore since they've ripped off six straight wins. Tough game tonight. I mean, Kent State is one. I mean, they are a game-type team, and I agree with you. When you look at that number initially, it stings you, but that number's there for a reason. Looking at Kent, Miami of Ohio, not the greatest team, beat them up by 13 fairly easily. Heading back, I mean, the one game that you want to zero in on, it's hard to pound Northern Illinois. They busted them up by 20 points at home, playing defense, holding them to 45 overall points, and then before that, they can play that up-tempo game when Central Michigan came to town, beat them by 10 points and topped the 100 mark. So Buffalo's one of the deepest teams in the MAC. That's why they can run that revolving door at you each and every game. I would lean to, I mean, again, I'm not big on laying anything over 5-6 points at home or even on the road, so to speak. I would lean towards Kent here because I think they have enough ammunition to keep this one close, but I'm not ready to step in front of Buffalo and say, you know, I'm going to absolutely take this game. I like Buffalo heading down the stretch, but that 7 just sticks out a little bit too much. I probably would lean towards getting the points here with Kent State.
Ohio, Miami of Ohio. Look, I like Ohio. Without Campbell, though, all year, I'm not crazy about laying 7-point numbers with them. Look, 3.5, 4, okay, but 7, not interested. Michael Weathers, pretty good player for Miami of Ohio. Listen, they're another team. They're well coached. They're going to play hard. But nothing really interests me in this one. Eastern Michigan at Ball State. Ball State laying 2.5, over under 152. If you could figure out Eastern Michigan, I'd like to hear from you. This team has really struggled in conference to cover, 4-10 this year. And you look at Ball State, I mean, they've been a mess this year against spread as well. This would be a total pass for me. The one thing I might recommend, maybe over 152, but again, this one opened 148. Obviously, the masses agree with me on this one. I don't have much here.
Yeah, I don't have much here either. It's always tough. Eastern Michigan's going to come out and play a lot of that 1-3-1 zone, which can technically throw a team off. The one thing I do like about Ball State is they do have a nice high-low presence. Franco House is a very good down-low scorer, almost in that Charles Barkley type of mode. And coming into the game, before the season started, Jeff, Eastern Michigan was predicted to be one of the best teams in the MAC. Now slipping off six straight losses in conference. You know, Western Michigan, Ohio, Akron, Toledo. I mean, they're good ball clubs. Last win they had was a bad Miami of Ohio team. But going on the road, I mean, can you really trust them? I do think the line actually is a little bit short. So people are still trying to give Eastern Michigan that nod. But again, look at Eastern Michigan. Not only are they losing, Jeff, 0-5 in their last five games, 0-5 against the number as well. It's a short line here. Just give me the home team with the short line.
Yeah, this Eastern team is really, I mean, the problem with them has been defensively. They're not getting stops lately. They're giving up over 81 points a game, and that's kind of been the MO for them over the years, not only in football, but in basketball as well. They can't get stops. Let's move to the Horizon. Listen, I piled it on them week after week, day after day, Cleveland State is awful. They're a hideous basketball team. Why they're laying points here, I don't know. I think if you're going to back Detroit, it would be in Callahan Hall. That's where I'd look to back Detroit Mercy. Look, Cleveland State is bad at home. Now they're going to lay points on the road. I'll take the points with Detroit Mercy here.
Yeah, I mean, it's an interesting type of environment that they're going to be playing in. Detroit, I always like the way they play basketball. Cleveland State, watching them early on in the season, I mean, they do like to try to get a little bit tougher out of conference. I watched them get pounded by Kentucky, but that was with a couple of their players. Played a little bit better versus Wright State. I believe, Jeff, didn't you have that game, sweating that one out a little
bit? Yeah, I did. I gave out Wright State as a free play. Yeah, I mean, that Wright State team, that's kind of been their MO this year. This conference in general, like the middle tier teams, the Wright States, the Northern Kentuckys, the UICs, they play really close games generally. But yeah, I had Wright State the other day. Yeah,
in this situation, I actually a little bit, you know, leaning towards the opposite side with taking Cleveland State here. If you look at their overall schedule, they already beat Detroit, which again, I don't give too much credence, you know, in a past previous game, because it's hard to beat a team, you know, unless you're Kentucky going up against one of the bottom feeders in one of these smaller type conferences, to beat them twice on the road. But they did play very tight against Oakland, dropping that one by 2 points. Valpo, who's clearly the class of the conference, beat them up a little bit. Beat UIC. Also played a tough game with Northern Kentucky, double overtime versus Wright State. I think Cleveland State's turning the corner a little bit with playing with teams of their own caliber. I'm going to look for Cleveland State to get the win and the cover tonight on the road.
Yeah, I definitely disagree here. I'm not interested. I hate Cleveland State. I hate this team. I bet on them. I bet against them week after week. I think Detroit, listen, Jaleel Hogan is a good player. I think he's the best player on the court. Him and Corey Allen, I think, will be able to handle. I'll be honest, I would take Detroit Mercy straight up plus the 130 here. I think this is a good spot for those guys to get the job done here. They usually play a lot better at home. So, listen, I mean, but again, it looks like sharp action betting Cleveland State here. So, I don't know. Maybe they know something. Wright State, Northern Kentucky, there we go. I've talked about Northern Kentucky all year. I think they're growing as a team. They've only been in Division I for, you know, a year or two now. Drew Holland's a good player. You know, I like what they do there. But, you know, Wright State here, another team that, you know, I almost want to kill myself every time I bet on them. I'm not in love with this one. Any opinion here?
Not really. I mean, they're coming in winning four straight, albeit Wright State. They do have one of my favorite players in the conference because I'm a big fan of the big white three-point shooter,
sure,
so to speak. And
sure,
they do have Benziger shooting almost 43% from three. They are a decent overall shooting team, and it is fun to watch there. But I don't have much on the game other than them winning, I guess it will be 5 out of 6 games leaning in that direction. But nothing I'll put my money on there, Jeff.
Yeah, I mean, for what it's worth, Northern Kentucky 9-2 at home this year straight up. They have played pretty well there. But, you know, Wright State, definitely a team that can hang with them. This one could come down to the wire. You might be best to just take the points here. But, you know, it's not a game that I'm rushing to bet at all. Let's just run through these quick. We got a couple more to do here. Youngstown, Oakland, no opinion. George Mason, Detroit, I'm going to pass. Wisconsin, Milwaukee, Valpo. Milwaukee looks like they would get thrashed here, especially with Valpo off a loss. You would think they would come out and thrash Milwaukee at home. Milwaukee, 65 points a game on the road, not good. Green Bay, Illinois, Chicago. I think the Illinois-Chicago train is almost pretty much off the tracks at this point. They were really covering.
Flames.
Yeah, they're up in flames. They've failed to cover in 3 of 5. They're just, I don't know. They were good early on, but I kind of recognized to jump off their train. When they got crushed by Oakland or Valpo a couple weeks ago, I kind of got off of them. So I would probably join the party if I were you there. Wichita hosting Evansville. Listen, I've heard a lot of talk. You know, I see a couple. I know my boy Gabriel from VIP Barbershop. He's talking about Wichita State. It's senior night. They're ranked. Listen, I don't like teams that become ranked. That's not a thing that I'm looking for. Listen, I know Wichita is very good at home against the spread, and I'm not going to bet against them here, but I'm not going to bet on them either. I like what Evansville has done lately.
Yes.
They're playing well. They've covered 4 or 5. They're shooting the ball at a nice percentage. Listen, at the end of the day, you know, I don't know about you, Donnie, but I don't like a team that just gets ranked, especially a team that should always be ranked. Listen, Evansville's not good, but at the end of the day, Marty Simmons is a good coach. He's a guy that has a lot of history in that conference. And Jaylen Brown is a really he's a really good player. Reminds you a lot of DJ Ballantyne, who they had for several years there. But it's hard to get in front of Wichita State at home. They should roll here, but I'm just going to tell you, Evansville has played better lately.
Yeah, I mean, I've been on Evansville a couple times over the past weeks. I mean, anytime you're laying, you know, in conference, and it's not even like, hey, you know, 13, 14, 15, you're going to get in most places there, Jeff, about 21 points. And the one thing I always look for is when you're getting a team that's, you know, a much better team, the other side of the table, I need somebody who can fill it up, who can just go off and sort of carry his team. And that's what Jaylen Brown can do. If you're looking at a team that's not as talented, can really get stopped on defense, I agree. I mean, Wichita State will run you over. But Jaylen Brown can play on that capability and move the ball around himself. If he goes for 20 to 25, which he's very capable of, you know, late in the game, does Wichita State care if they're up 25 with 5 minutes to go? Are they going to say, let's make it 35? No, they're going to probably say, let's let some of the other guys get in. And as you said, if it is senior night and the last home game, you're going to look to clear your bench and get some of those guys who never get in the game the last 3 minutes, and that's when you can make up that that cover.
Yeah, I agree with you there. I think you're 100% right. You know, and again, I've made it clear, I hate betting against Wichita at home, but you know, we can't get away from the fact that it is late in season. Guys are looking to get their guy. Greg Marshall's going to look to get his team some rest, get those seniors out of there on a nice, you know, nice night.
Nice so, ovation with 3 minutes to go. There you go.
Yeah,
you can run off a nice 6-7-0 run to end the game and get that late cover.
Yep. Davidson Richmond. This one just went to two. Not crazy about laying points with Davidson ever. Seems like if Jack Gibbs and Peyton Eldridge aren't playing well, they don't play well. Richmond off of a stinging loss, a game in which I think was a lot closer than the score indicated. No real opinion there. NC State, Georgia Tech. Listen, if you're interested in betting NC State right now, I think you should have your fucking head examined. There's no reason to bet NC State now at all. Do you have any viable reason that I should back NC State right now?
No, I mean, we talked about it earlier. It's one of those games where, you know,
who is betting NC State here?
Like, they want to see, yeah, exactly. Like, well, short money, they're going to show up. Is there anything worse than somebody who doesn't care? How about when you just go to your job every day and you know the guy over you is leaving in 2 weeks and he doesn't give a damn because his pay is going to be the same for 2 weeks and doesn't care about anything? That's NC State. And, you know, when you're a young kid, the same thing with the substitute teacher. Godfrey's gone at the end of the year. You think they give a damn if they practice hard or even worry about the game plan for the rest of the season? Like, dude, I got 3 years to go and this guy's out of here. I'm going to do me.
And you think Dennis Smith gives a flying fuck? I mean, he's gone anyway.
He's like, oh, NBA, I'm going to cash that ticket. I don't want to get hurt. And was it, which game was it, Jeff, where, like, you know, somebody was trying to fight a fan in the stands? Dennis Smith was like, hey, you know what? I don't even want to be in this game anymore. Just take me out. That team is a complete train wreck mess. There's no such thing as sharp money on a team that doesn't give a damn.
And now you're laying points on the road against a team who cannot lose. Yeah, listen. I respect people that are sharp guys, but listen, sometimes you just got to stop overthinking things. We're not doing fucking brain surgery here. We're betting on sports. You win or lose. There's no way in hell I would back NC State tonight.
No, again, it gets back. Like, you can't even have, like, even if you pick NC State, like, sharp money doesn't even make sense here because you're dealing with a team that is just has a fork in them. Like, what is the sharp money? Like, NC State's going to say, you know what? Our coach got fired on Saturday. We got blown out by Notre Dame. We're supposed to, you know, make that last stand. And we love our coach. We're going to show how much we play for him. Now you're going to tell me 2 days later, let's go on the road in conference with a team that's basically a bubble team. And we're going to go make another last stand. I don't buy it.
Yeah, I'm not sure anyone said they were laying points anyway. I don't know.
I think you actually did by accident. Yeah,
yeah, maybe I did. I meant to say, clearly they're not laying points. That was obviously something I said out of context. I just was stumbling over words, I guess. Georgia Tech's laying 2.5 here. Yeah, there's no way in hell that I would lay yeah, I'm going to just move on because I don't.
What's interesting about that too, Jeff, just looking at the money, I'd see Chris open the line at 5.5 and it's now like 2.5, 3. I don't understand any of that. I don't know. You know what? I'm not going to have any money on this game, but it's one of those games now that I actually want to watch because I want to see it actually unfold to see if Georgia Tech gets a 15-point win or at the end of the game going, like, damn, NC State actually really showed up. I'm actually interested in the game now for no apparent reason.
Yeah, I guess, you know, you got to give the guy respect, Gottfried. Yep, I got you. You got to give respect to Gottfried for sticking it out. You know, I actually think he's a better coach than they lead on. I mean, he's I don't know that it's his fault that they're that bad. You know, but then again, maybe it is. I don't know. But we'll move on here. Rest of the card here. St. John's Marquette. I see a lot of, you know, love in this game. I don't really see it. I don't think, Frank, they have any way to Georgia Tech has no there's no way right now they can let down. They're squarely on the bubble. I don't think they have the ability to let down. I'm sorry. Scott Weaver chiming in. I have a feeling you would chime in. Scott will try to wrap up and say that NC State's worth a play here. But, you know, Scott, sorry. I love you. I respect you a lot. I'm not interested here. Sorry. Yeah, I think Gottfried's had a bad rap as well. I don't really get why he's the fall guy here. He seemingly is the fall guy in certain situations. But, you know, for what it's worth, I mean, he hasn't been that bad. I mean, they've been to the NCAA tournament, you know, four to five years. Obviously won't make it this year, so 4 of 6. But I'm not sure, again, what else he's supposed to do here.
Yeah, that's just a bad spot there, Jeff. I mean, when you're down in Tobacco Row and it's Duke and Carolina and it's what have you done for me lately, why can't you compete with those guys? They're going to hold you to an unfair advantage versus a team that you just can't compete with. And that's just what he's falling into. He's going to get a nice golden parachute to get out of there. They'll put another coach in there, and he'll have the same type of record as Gottfried. They'll blow him out, too, saying, why can't you be Coach K? Why can't you beat Carolina? Same thing every single year, every single coach with NC State down there.
Yeah, I mean, it doesn't help. I mean, they did lose, you know, guys early. I mean, Trevor Lacey went to the draft early. You know, people, you know, Kyle Washington left the program, which hurt. I mean, he's doing a lot of good things at Cincinnati now. You know, they definitely, Ralston Turner graduated. I mean, they did lose some things lately, but, you know, look, I mean, you get Dennis Smith, you should be competing. You know, Tyler Lewis left, went to Butler. So, yeah, I mean, he's had some problems. I don't know what happened, but, you know, good luck to Mark Gottfried. Next here, a couple more here. Northwestern Illinois, I don't know. I mean, Northwestern, another team, I'm not sure they have the ability late to really take a game lightly. I think they're well coached. I don't think they're a team that will do that. Illinois, I think, ready for the season to end. Indiana, Iowa, good luck.
Can we just sink Indiana into the ocean for once and for all,
yeah,
by the way?
Yeah, sink Crean and get in there.
On the bubble, when are they going to play well? Are they going to do this? Are they going to do that? Come on,
right, man. Right. And, I mean, you look at these two coaches. I mean, is there anybody you want to back less than Fran McCaffrey or Tom Crean? I mean, really. I'm good. A couple more here. Akron lands 6 at Bowling Green. You and I talked about this, Donnie. Akron off a loss. I think they're the best team in the MAC. I think they will end up winning this conference. Maybe Buffalo will give them some trouble. You know, Bowling Green has turned it up on the offensive end, but you look at defensively. I mean, it's hard to do what Bowling Green has done lately. I mean, they're giving up over the last 5 games. I'm not sure I've seen numbers worse than this in a 5-game period. They're giving up 91 points a game and allowing 56% from the field. A pissed-off Akron team coming in. This one has double-digit written all over it.
Yeah, it really does have the makings. The one thing is Akron always tends to get in that conference a little bit overvalued just because they are, I believe, the same thing, the best team. Maybe 15-2 straight up last 17, only 1-6 against the number, but that's just because they're laying, you know, somewhere around that double-digit range. The one thing that Bowling Green sometimes has an advantage with in the MAC conference is DiMaggio Wiggins is a tough out down low, 6'10", super athletic guy, but he's a wire compared to Isaiah. And what he, I mean, you know, big boy Isaiah from Akron, he's going to get after it down low. The one thing I love, and you hear me talk about all the time, is the inside-outside game. If you have a kid down low that can absolutely dominate, and then you have three-point shooters that can bury it, Akron's the perfect storm in that conference. I don't think Bowling Green can score with them, and whatever they had in an advantage sometimes in the MAC with Wiggins, completely lost tonight with Isaiah Johnson.
Yeah, and like you said, again, off a loss, you got to – Keith Dambrot, you know, again, I know they don't cover, which is tough, but I think that's the whole thing of, well, the numbers they're laying are a little too high. They're still a good road team. I think in this spot, I think they come out and pound Bowling Green. Two, three more here. East Carolina, Tulane. I don't have anything on this game. I'm never interested in Tulane. Again, I think the burning question in 2016 and 17, why Mike Dunleavy's coaching at Tulane. Again, at his age, I don't really get it. Colorado State, New Mexico. You know, I think Colorado State, as far as a road team, very good on the road. 9-1 this year to the number. You know, they've been good as a dog. With no Tim Williams, it's weird because with no Tim Williams, they're still – I mean, they're still scoring,
they're
which is interesting.
Good ball. Yeah. I don't understand. I can't fathom that. And every time we talked earlier on that, Jeff, when I said, look at New Mexico State, and you say, oh, I don't like the way they play ball. If you look at it, what do they want, 7 of 8 games? I mean, without their best player, it's baffling that they're still able to win because the offense isn't very pretty.
Right. Yeah, but, I mean, you do look at Colorado State, very good road team, good defensively, much better than what New Mexico is going to throw at you. You know, I don't know. Colorado State should win this one. Covell is a good player. Plus 115 may be the play here. One more, Monmouth Fairfield. Listen, I've said it before. I hate this conference. It's just disgusting. I hate betting on these teams. But I'm interested in Fairfield as an underdog, probably. I don't know. That's just me.
No, I think you have the right thought in that one. But always in this conference, you know, we talked even with Ian Cameron earlier. You know me, Jeff. I love stepping out in front of Iona. And for two or three games about 3 weeks ago, it wasn't working out. Now they're 0-3 against the number. It's one of those games again. Monmouth, to me, is the best team in that conference, the most complete team. And every time you want to say, you know, I'm going to go against Monmouth, they always show up. You know what I mean? It's one of those games where I'm looking and saying Fairfield is a ready, viable underdog. Probably if you can get 6, that's a fantastic line to get. But do you want to bet against Monmouth? Because they can run you right 80-60 on the road. It doesn't matter.
Yeah, I mean, and that's the thing. And that's why, for me, I just hate this conference and I don't want to bet on it. You know, that's kind of my general thinking with this with this conference. Fairfield got crushed by Monmouth back on the 91-49. I mean, that's pretty bad. I mean, they shot 29% in that game. I don't know. For me,
Monmouth, I mean, just if they haven't had any, you know, real letdown spots. I mean, it's always tough when you go to Drady and play Manhattan. You know, they only picked up a win by 4 points. But they busted a very good offensive Siena team, hammered Niagara. I mean, they're coming in and well-rested too, Jeff. Haven't played since Thursday, so it's not one of those where we got to get on the bus and go all the way out to Niagara or Siena, go to upstate New York. It's a very short ride for them, and they should be ready for this one.
Yeah, I hear you. I'm going to pass. Someone's asking us if it's a trap line. I don't know. I mean,
I think it's actually a really good line, to be honest with you. If that line was somewhere around, let's say, Monmouth -2.5 or -3, that would be one that's really pointing. But I think that line is pretty fair as to what Monmouth can bring to the table versus Fairfield tonight. I don't know so much as a trap. I think it's pretty good.
Okay. Yeah, for me, tonight I'm going to go with Ole Miss +1.5, Virginia Tech on the money line. And I'm also going to go with Kentucky. I'll lay the big number -16. Let's switch gears, Donnie. And I don't know if you want to hang around. I was just going to talk a little bit NBA free agency here, kind of the goings on with everything with you know, the Sixers. First of all, with the Sixers, I'm not sure what they're waiting on with Jahlil Okafor. From what I understand, you know, they've been actively trying to move Jahlil Okafor. Time's starting to dwindle here a little bit. I don't know what the market is. I don't really know if you're a team, why you'd want Jahlil Okafor at this point. to me, comes across as kind of a bust, to be honest. He plays nothing as far as defense is concerned. Maybe he needs a change of scenery. I think he was obviously vilified from the beginning. When they got Joel Embiid, I think it was kind of, addition by subtraction. They didn't need him at any point anymore. What's your Jahlil Okafor opinion?
I mean, disappointing to say the least. But the one thing I do disagree a little bit is you have, a cost-effective player who can score coming off the bench over the next couple of years. I wouldn't just cut bait with them unless you can get, nobody's going to give you, a bad team's not going to give you and say, hey, we'll give you a first-round pick, which is going to end up in the top 10. You're probably looking at one of those trades where, it's going to be lottery-protected, and maybe you don't, trade him to a really good team where it turns out to be the 28th overall pick. But I would hold on to him, and maybe, a center goes down next year, even that, or maybe Embiid doesn't even work out for the Sixers, meaning that he just gets completely hurt all the time and just can't step it up with the foot injuries or maybe the new knee injuries there. I'm not a big Jahlil Okafor fan, so to speak, but I wouldn't just give him away. Get a second round pick or some bum, from some other team, and you just cut him at the end of the year anyway. I would hold on. Maybe he drops some body weight, becomes a little bit better player, and then you might be even able to get him as a trade next year.
Yeah, I guess I just think, he's not needed anymore. I don't think future-wise he's going to really play into much of what they're doing. Nerlens Noel and Embiid and, even like a depth player. I would take Rashawn Holmes over him, to be honest with you.
Mac action right there.
Bowling Green, right. Good call. I don't know if you noticed, I had a run-in with his mother a couple weeks ago.
I saw that. Yeah. Did she retweet you or something?
Yeah, I actually was critical of Holmes in a game, and she reached out to me and was – I mean, I give it to her. She's defending her kid, which, right. I don't know. I guess she was just searching his name and – which is kind of odd. I feel like if you're that critical – but if you're that critical, why are you on Twitter, you should know that you're going to get shit for it. Listen, I see Vlade Divac getting the a lot of shit talked about him. Listen, I got to tell you, I don't get why people are so hateful of what they did there. It's clear DeMarcus Cousins wasn't working there. How many years do we have to go before they thought, it's just not working? DeMarcus is a great player. I love him. I think he's the best big in the league. But then you look at what they got back. I mean, they got a player in Buddy Hield who I think it's way too early to know how good he'll be. I don't really get how many shooting guards you need on a team and fail before you realize. I think this team's just trying to tank, kind of do what the Sixers did in a way. They unloaded a guy in Cousins who wasn't going to work there, didn't want to be there, had five coaches fired. Trey made a good point last night. I think their haul they got back is actually pretty good, to be honest. I mean, they got rid of a guy in Cousins who wasn't going to work anyway. The Kings aren't going to win anything. I think it's time to totally rethink what you're doing there. I think if you can get something out of Buddy Hield long term, I still think Collison has stuff left in the tank. Who knows what Malachi Richardson will become. They're going to build. They got a big draft class coming in as far as what you can get this year as far as draft class is concerned. They got some picks back for it. I don't get the hate with the deal, to be honest.
I don't even think Sacramento even had a choice in this one. I mean, if you look at the way DeMarcus Cousins came into the league, it's the same issues that he has now. I mean, a major attitude problem. Great player. I mean, he's, would you say at least a top 10 player in the NBA talent-wise? I don't think there's too much of an argument. But at the same time, with the new salary cap and the new salary structure, if DeMarcus Cousins is a pain in the neck now, wait until he makes like a quarter of what your franchise is worth, like $250 million on a contract. He is going to have his say. He's going to run coaches out of town, run teams out of town, run owners out of the town, and he's going to say, I'm going to make $35 million a year, whether or not I play or don't play or care about playing. You can't do that as a franchise, and that's why you only got the haul. If you don't think the haul was that good, that's why you only got that haul. I mean, he should have brought back two superstar players and a great first-round draft pick, but you take what you can get with a guy that at any minute can ruin your team.
Yeah, I mean, they got a first-round pick in 2017 and a second-rounder, plus you got Buddy Hield, who was a lottery pick. I mean, I just don't understand what else you wanted in that case. And listen, Divac's absolutely – to say he had a better deal 2 days ago was idiotic. I don't know why he brought that up. If that was the case, why – you know, why admit it publicly? They also cut ties with Matt Barnes, who's a head case as well. Tenuous issues there with him. Listen, the Kings aren't going to win anything, and without Cousins, they're not very good. Actually, they're one of the worst teams in the league. But I think long term, I think they'll be, you know, they'll build. They got to rebuild at some point. As far as the Pelicans, they get back Cousins. Listen, again, I'm not really sure how just by adding him you become a contender. I hear constant talk how they're contenders now. I mean, are you kidding?
Like, they're gonna be like Memphis.
I mean, really, are we kidding? Are we kidding with that statement? I mean, really? Because now you have two guys on the block that demand the basketball. You have nothing at the power forward position. Etwan Moore is your shooting guard. And Drew Holiday, who's made more mistakes this year than I've ever seen. Drew Holiday's had some issues. I mean, and again, I wouldn't mind him on the Sixers. He's a decent point guard. I don't think he's a point guard you're going to win anything with. I mean, really. Buddy's weak. He's only been in the league for 3 months. What are you talking about? He's weak. It's way too early. Way too early. I don't think the Pelicans are at all going to be a contender. I don't know why we're talking about, well, if they can get to the eighth seed. I mean, they're bad. I mean, they're 23-34. I guess they're only three or four games back from that eighth seed, but I still think Portland's a better team. Dallas has played better. I don't know. I don't think they're contenders right now. Sorry. But yeah, they need some guards. If they can add a guard or two, maybe. They definitely have the best front court, but just because they have a great front court doesn't mean a whole lot. Still have to be able to shoot the ball and play some defense. Other than that, Donnie, anything else that you've seen in sports that you want to bring up today?
No, the one thing I do like is I always get a laugh at is now Magic is going to be running the Lakers. Like, that's going to work out really well. And he said he's going to bring in, like, Kobe Bryant to help out. We all know how that goes. Just, I mean, get a real GM in there. Stop with the whole family business and everybody wants to be a Laker. Everybody shunned them. It was a dog and pony show, Kobe's last 2 years, where you didn't care about winning. You're maxing the guy out, paying him like $35 million a year. The team stinks. They can't get any better. You can't build young. And now you're going to come back 1 year later after Kobe's gone, you know, clean house. I mean, I don't agree, you know, Mitch Kupchak and, you know, the brother Buss over there who hasn't been that good, but putting it in Magic's hands and just, you know, what he's going to do with it, it's just not a good look.
Yeah, I mean, because he works out so good as a coach, right?
Yeah, exactly. Like, I mean, some the best basketball players, I mean, hey, well, Jerry West was a great basketball player, fantastic GM. I just look at Magic as one of those guys just going to come in and just start, you know, trading away draft picks and assets and trying to get, like, you know, Tim Duncan in town and stuff like that. Just, I don't think that's going to go anywhere. I thought they should have went a better, sharper angle, a nice young up-and-coming GM who saw the future, not somebody who's just your star guard back in the day. Now that your team stinks, you want to try to sell tickets because Magic runs the team.
And by the way, for anyone vilifying Buddy Hield, first of all, he just turned 23. And again, he's only been in the league for several months, by the way, on a bad team. So let's just, before we pass judgment on Buddy Hield, let's just wait a little bit because, you know, out of college, I mean, no one thought Steph Curry would be what he is today. So you never know. One question, Donnie. The Pacers' sources have told ESPN that they would be willing to part with a first-round pick if they got the right deal. So they're readily interested in Jahlil Okafor. I mean, you got to go with that deal if you can get that, no?
Honestly, I don't know. I might. I mean,
come
do
on.
You think that deal would still be on the table next year? Like, what's the worst thing that can happen?
Yeah, but I think
your deal, I think, can only get better if you're the Sixers now. I mean, you are loaded for bear over the next 2 years with draft picks, stock, talent. Everything is really about turning the corner. Why would you just give up an asset when let's just say you have to let Big John walk in 2 years. Just let him walk. I mean, the pot of gold is over the next year and a half that they're going to get in the drafts. If they end up getting the Lakers, I mean, take a look this year. If you get, like, number one and number six overall, it's a wrap. That pick's not even going to mean anything. Maybe you just leave Julio on the bench and maybe you flip him over when it's even better in the next 2 years.
Yeah, I hear you. It's definitely going to be interesting. I mean, obviously, you know, they haven't been quick to make a move yet. You know, I guess it's better than making a bad move, you know. But
yeah, I mean, you can go out there and get that, you know, we'll trade you away for a non-protected pick to a, you know, a contender team, and you end up being the 29th pick. But you're always going to be able to get that. I would just hold on to him and just see what's what down the road. And maybe you do just deal him where he just doesn't have a spot on the team. The one thing I do appreciate with Jahlil Okafor, I can't imagine if you're in his position, the way he, you know, don't come on the team playing, sit out. I know you're healthy. You're not going to play tonight. Hasn't made a peep, which can only help, because if he came out and just raised, like, you know, hell, which what he should be doing, you might only get like a second round pick, or just have to let the guy go for like a veteran level exception.
Yeah, no, he's definitely handled the situation particularly well. I've heard rumblings down there that his dad has been a lot more vocal than he has. His dad's always around.
Even looking to the future, like, how are you going to feel? Let's just say the Sixers are in position to take Ball out of UCLA. His dad is going to be a nightmare for any one of these teams.
Oh, yeah. No, I wanted to – we're going to talk about that more tomorrow on the show, Right Side of Campus. We're going to talk more about that tomorrow. Last thing, whatever happened to Nerlens Noel, what happened to him? Nothing's happened to him. He's a starter in this league playing with the Sixers, and he's been very good, actually, lately. You look at over the last 10 games, I mean, he's been what they need him to be right now. Nerlens isn't going to be a great scorer. He's a basically an up-and-coming. You know, I think if they can get half of what Ben Wallace was with Nerlens Noel, they'll be happy with that. You know, he's been a pretty good rebounder since coming into the league. He's averaging a block a game. Listen, Sixers are going to get better. I think Nerlens is a guy they'll build around, and Embiid as well. He's a great complement to Embiid, I think. And I think he'll turn into be that. Other than that, Donnie, anything else tonight?
No, nothing tonight, but I'm really looking forward to tomorrow and Friday, kicking it off tomorrow on SBR. It's going to be a lot of fun. And I said, like, you know, we're going to go have a show at 12:30, and we're going to go meet down at the Leah Cora Center and watch some good basketball, lay some wagers, and have a lot of fun.
Yeah, it's going to be fun, guys. Again, feel free to join us tomorrow, 12:30 on the dot. You know, watch us over your lunch break. You know, watch us. You know, if you need something to get your juices flowing with a little bit of college basketball, we'll talk about everything. You can jump on the Google chat and chat with us as well. And then, like Donnie said, you know, head down to the Temple South Central Florida game, watch little Taco Fall. Yeah, I'm excited to see him live. You know, that'll be cool.
Yeah, big man, big goggles. We'll have some good seats. We'll have a good time, man.
Yeah, should be fun. So, guys, as always, you have a question on anything, feel free to reach out. We'll make sure we get out the link to everyone tomorrow, and hopefully we see you tomorrow on the live chat there at SBR Picks. And you can follow them, SBR Sports Picks. That's where the link will be tweeted out. You'll have Donnie and I both tomorrow on the Right Side of Campus. Donnie, thanks for coming on, man, and filling in for Ryan. Ryan would have been here today, but he had a prior something he had to do. He actually just walked in the door a minute ago. So everyone have a great night. Thanks, as always, Donnie, for joining us. Appreciate it, man.
Have a good one.
Thanks, man. Again, Donnie Wrightside joining us here live on the show. That'll be it for the show tonight, guys. As always, join us tomorrow. We will not have a show tomorrow night, obviously due to going to the game. I'll be back Thursday, though, with another edition. Most of my free plays will be given out on tomorrow's SBR show. Make sure you join us, 12:30 Eastern. As always, I'm the Big Man on Campus. Three plays for me tonight: Ole Miss +1.5, Vatek Moneyline, and Kentucky -16. Those are free plays. No one's holding the gun to your head to bet them. I've won member play tonight. Hopefully the premium can get the job done. We'll be back tomorrow. Join us live at SBR Sports Picks. Everyone have a great night. Bye-bye.